Amistad and Harper Audio present Wade in the Water, a novel by Nyani Nkrumah, performed by Eboni Flowers and Teri Schnaubelt. For Mansa Nkrumah, with love. Part 1. Chapter 1. Ricksville, Mississippi, summer 1982. There weren't many people I loved when I was 11, but I loved Mr. Maccabee. I knew he couldn't be my daddy because he was too old, but I always thought of him as my granddad, even though I'd never had one. Mr. Maccabee said his blindness gave him the second sight, that he could see deep into souls. I didn't believe him one lick. "I go to Sunday school," I would say sharply to him. "Only God sees into souls." He would grin back at me, his partly toothless smile reminding me of my 7-year-old cousin, Devin. I ran all the way down Ricksville Road to get to Mr. Maccabee's house at number 2, feeling the last memories of school fade with every step I took. I wanted to keep that feeling going all day, so I dawdled by Cammie's house, wishing she hadn't gone away to her father somewhere up in Indian Reserve country, and dodged around that half-naked crazy Sammy who shouted obscenities at anyone who came within his sight. Finally, I was at Mr. Maccabee's. Mr. Maccabee lived on the right, 5 houses down from mine. I walked up the porch stairs and up to his front door. I pushed the door open and went inside, and there he was, sitting in that old wicker chair. I went right up to him like I always did and stared into his milky eyes, willing him to open them and see me. He was wearing a dirty, torn, pale blue shirt. My eyes swept up and down to scrutinize his skinny frame, taking in the overgrown gray beard that partially covered strong, carved-out, oak-colored features, and finally settled on his worn and calloused feet. Every inch of him was as familiar as the red dirt that filled the potholes on our street.
"That you, Ella?"
"Yes, it's me, Mr. Maccabee. Just wanted to tell you that we won the Ricksville mud battle this morning." The mud battle happened only in May, a few days after school ended, and it had to have rained enough for the soil to get so sopping wet that we could scoop it up like clay and mold it into balls. The battle was one side of the street against the other, and every child between the ages of 4 and 14 had been outside hurling mud balls.
"Heard you all are hollering this morning. Couldn't even sleep in. Must think I'm deaf, too."
He took his time packing tobacco into his pipe, and I stood by his side, close as I could, while he finished. "How are your legs doing?" I asked.
"Still not working as good as they should, Ella. You've been asking me the same question since you were 6.
"Because I'm still waiting on God. He'll fix those up good as new. Same as your eyes." I looked at him again, wishing that what I believed would just flow from my eyes into his brain.
"Ella, why are you always waiting on a miracle? Those don't come by here often, you know."
"I know God can make many miracles," I said. I was tired of having to convince Mr. Maccabee that if he believed hard enough, he would see. He was so old, you'd think he would know these things by now. But no, I always had to tell him. "Have you seen Fats around here?" I asked.
"Why you all keep calling that boy such a horrible name? What if people started calling me blind old Mr. Maccabee? Would that be nice?"
I wanted to tell him that everyone did call him blind old Mr. Maccabee when they were talking about him. But I didn't want to make him mad because then Mr. Maccabee would raise that cane of his and bring it down every which way about, and you'd have to duck just in case it hit you.
"He was just here, not 10 minutes afore you, looking twice as muddy.
Fats was my second best friend, after Cammy. Everyone called him Fats, even his ma. Every single part of his body was round, from his full, soft, bulging lips to his pudgy, rolling belly. Fats was the color of sandpaper. But when you looked carefully, that color seemed to depend on which part of his body you were looking at. His face was like butterscotch, all smooth and warm, but his belly, hanging out over swim trunks, was pale and pasty, like the underbelly of an octopus, while his arms and legs were a chocolate brown. Mr. McAbee reached and took my thumb out of my mouth and put his hand in mine. I could feel the calluses in lumps and bumps under the hardness of his palm. I could never figure out how he knew the minute my thumb was in my mouth. He had long grown tired of telling me that I was too old for that and I'd get rabbit teeth.
"You all right, baby girl?"
he asked me.
"Things all right at home?"
I nodded.
"Leroy still away?"
I hesitated, not wanting to say anything because maybe Mr. McAbee had that second sight that made him sense things no one else did. But in those seconds I waited, Mr. McAbee's voice was back again, sharper. He was now leaning forward, looking through me, trying to see deep into my soul again. I kept it out of his reach, buried it way, way down.
"Is he back?"
"No, he's still away." I managed to keep the wobble out of my voice.
"That man's been away almost 9 months this time."
Mr. McAbee seemed to be talking to himself again. He leaned back in his chair. Leroy, my stepfather, was Ma's husband and the father of my sister and brothers. I knew he hated me, couldn't stand to look at me. I wanted Mr. McAbee to go right on talking about something else and not try to look into my soul, so I said quickly, "You going to be all right?"
"Yes, don't you worry that pretty head of yours over me. Just hand me a clean shirt."
I went to get Mr. McAbee a clean shirt and came back with his favorite gray shirt with the white collar. "Want me to fix you a sandwich before I go?"
"That would be real nice. There's a piece of bacon in the fridge and some bread on the counter. Make sure you wash those grubby hands first."
I fried up the bacon and made the sandwich.
"Now, what's your new word for the day?"
he asked. "Preposterous."
"My, my, my, that's a handful for a little girl. You know what it means?"
"Yes," I said, rolling my eyes to give him some sass. "It means ridiculous, absurd, foolish, inane." Mr. McAbee could hear the sass right in my voice, but he only shook his head and said,
"You keep it up here now."
He stretched out his hand, and when I grasped it, he pulled me close to him for a quick hug. I ran down the street, past the tiny, mostly rented clapboard houses that made up my neighborhood in the black part of town, past the big old sign where, if you squinted, you could just make enough sense of the peeling red paint to read, "Town of Ricksville, MS, population 8,014. Past our neighborhood liquor store, past Fats's house at number 6, past Cammy's at number 8, until I reached the smallest house on Ricksville Road, number 12. It was a slightly lopsided house that you could just about tell used to be yellow. We lived in the poor, all-black neighborhood of South Ricksville, which on our classroom map was south of Main Street. Years back in 1964, Main Street and most of its stores had been burned to the ground in retaliation for what happened near Philadelphia, Mississippi, when the Ku Klux Klan had killed those young election workers turning out the black vote. All that had put in stone the open resentment between blacks and whites. And even though the white owners had rebuilt, We kids almost never ventured north of Main Street into the white part of town. Those lines, drawn in the sand between north and south, stayed unchanged over the years. Every child in Ricksville knew where they were supposed to be when the sun set. If we were sent to get something from the larger grocery 5 blocks into the north side, the moment the glow of the sun started to retreat, our feet had better be on North Perry. If darkness was moving in fast, we would have to run at full tilt. Only when we hit South Perry could our feet slow down, and our hearts steady, and our lungs fill with air. Then we would settle into a stroll, because from there, it was a straight shot from Perry to Woodlawn, Woodlawn to Grace, and Grace to Ricksville. And then we were finally home.
Chapter 2, Princeton, New Jersey, January 1981. She wore a white dress, one of those pretty cotton sheer dresses. She had felt like wearing a summer dress today, but it was freezing, so she had it on over her warmest wool turtleneck and her thickest leggings. The dress was sleeveless, gathered at her narrow waist. Pearly buttons ran down the front of its length, just stopping short above her ankle. She was all fingers and thumbs as she tried to button it up quickly. She slipped on her black boots before stopping to glance at herself in the mirror. Her father, who preferred her all dressed up the older she got, would have approved of the dress, all southern and demure. But he wouldn't have liked the shoes nor the turtleneck. She never was one for mooning in front of mirrors, but she took a glance at herself out of habit. She knew what she was, nondescript. She had shoulder-length straight brown hair, brown eyes, and pale white skin that burned easily in the sun. An everyday person that barely afforded a second glance. She made up for that with a well-placed belt or shoes, something that would cause them to take another look, if not at her face, then at the rest of her, which she knew was very well proportioned. She would be late, and she couldn't afford to be. She paced up and down the tiny apartment, searching, first for her black crossbody satchel, her coat, her journal, which she took everywhere with her, then her ruler and pens, and finally her watch, which she hurriedly shoved in the bag. She didn't stop to grab anything to eat, but almost ran down the stairs, jumping over the steps two at a time, till she was at the bottom. 10 minutes of brisk walking, and she was almost there. Relief at the sight of the massive, dark brick administration building ahead of her slowed her down a notch. 2 minutes later, she pushed through the large spring-loaded doors and immediately could hear them even before she saw them, a raucous crowd of students, the din of their excited voices filling the hallway. She joined the line in front of a long desk behind which sat 4 ladies, each busy registering second semester classes, papers and books strewn all over the desk in front of them. "Is Dr. Livenworth's class still open?" she called out, even as she stood 18th in line. "Wait your turn," someone said behind her. She turned and stared into a set of hazel eyes. It was an undergrad, lank brown hair, needing a cut. She made an impatient gesture.
"What's so important about getting a class with Livenworth anyway? Heard he's a terrible grader, a guaranteed C or below."
She had no time for him. She ignored all the babies, or so she called them, those 18-year-olds who were at least 14 years younger than she was. She was a graduate student, but certainly older than most of the graduate students in her year group. She screwed up her face in concentration. She considered buying someone's spot in the line, but she had not thought to bring cash with her. She had to get into this class, the rise of the black working class in America. Her advisor had said it would help her as she began her thesis research on the impact of the black migration and the civil rights movement on Southern society between 1940 and 1980. She had become more and more liberal since college, fully immersing herself in the diverse environment of NYU, where she had been an undergrad, and now at Princeton, her friends were a mix of every race, creed, and color under the sun, as were her interests. It was deliberate, and her thesis topic was just as deliberate as everything else she had done since she left the hospital. By the time she reached one of the registering ladies at the table, there was only one spot left in Dr. Livenworth's class. She almost wept in relief.
Chapter 3. I looked down at the state of my clothes after the mud battle. Ma would surely give me a hiding. So I left my shoes at the door and went upstairs to wash. I changed, put my dirty clothes in a bucket, and gave them a good scrub on the washing board, like Ma had taught me. Before hanging.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.